WBB129 of the World Beyond Belief. I'm your co-host, Mindy Erkin, and with me today, as always, is your host, Paul Marco.
Hi, it's nice to have you here with us, joining us for another episode of the World Beyond Belief. We've got an exciting one today and a very relevant one, so I hope you stick with us through our hours together. Before we get started, though, I want to talk a little bit about all the wonderful listeners that we have that have listened to and supported the Stand By Daniel campaign.
Yes, we are just amazed. We have had over 1,100 people listen to or watch the interview that we did with Daniel and aired here on Blog Talk last week. And we want to thank all of you on behalf of Daniel for supporting him in his efforts to overcome the attack from the FDA.
Right, and it's really amazing. We were able to mobilize people to get off of their couches and post things on Facebook and really go the extra mile for Daniel. I think because of the positive timeline that Daniel can win a suit against, I guess it's the Justice Department now, but it was filed originally by the FDA because he has something that can cure many of the very profitable business items that the pharmaceutical companies deal with. And they don't want you to cut in on their action. So they're taking Daniel to task. He's doing a very good job of preparing himself to get ready to defend all of our health freedom.
That's right. And if you haven't yet listened to that interview, please do tune in, listen to the interview, and stand by Daniel.
Right. Do you want to, how can they most easily see, it would be on our Pinecone Utopia channel.
Yes, you can go to our pineconeutopia.yolasite.com. That's our blog, and it is posted there. It's also posted on YouTube, and we have many, many videos posted on YouTube on the Pinecone Utopia channel.
So go to Pinecone Utopia. Do search, and then you'll see our channel come up. Go into the channel, and one of the first one or two that you'll encounter is the Stand By Daniel interview.
Right, and you'll see there, either there or in a description to this, a link to go to his blog so that you can support him as well and find out more.
Right. So we're going to keep you up to date on the Stand By Daniel campaign as we go through as much as we can. I don't know how much you can disclose outside of court proceedings, but we're going to try to keep you up to date on what's happening with that because we really need to win this one.
It's very important on behalf of all of us. I mean, not just Daniel and his family's life is at stake here. He's facing up to 37 years in prison, but he's standing for the rights of all of us to have freedom when it comes to choosing our methods, modalities of healing ourselves with natural products. So it's a very important cause.
Right. But anyway, today's topic, let me give you a topic overview of what we're going to cover today. We're going to talk about 911 initially because there's been some interesting new things come out. And I think it's time that we go back and revisit this because it's important. Actually, it's very important. I'm going to talk a little bit about the state of transformation, how I see the awakening unfolding, and how we can all participate in creating more of an awakening and fighting the forces for involution, as I used to call them.
That's right.
To keep us evolving on the consciousness level. Then we're going to switch in the second hour and go to Charlie Hebdo case in Paris, and I'm calling it a false flag right away, and so is everybody else in the alternative media. But let's look into that, who had skin in the game, who had things to gain, and who certainly didn't have anything to gain, and we'll look into that. Also, we're going to look at the solutions that are being offered up by There were many world leaders. 17 world leaders met in Paris They were all wearing black, and they're having a meeting on what they're going to do in response to this. Now, as if their response wasn't cooked up before the event, they're making new plans. And I saw them all lined up walking down the street, and I couldn't think of anything but a parade of puppets. All these people that are running these governments are simply puppets of the overlords. So it was a puppet parade. Now they're going to get together and roll out the plans that were initially hatched. But we'll get into that in the second hour. First of all, I want to talk about the transformation of consciousness that's going on the planet right now. There's an urge now, and there's an urge every so many years for us to do something constructive about freeing ourselves from the matrix and being able to expand our consciousness to an unlimited level. What I mean by that is that human beings have so much potential. They have so many abilities that the controllers don't have. We're creative. We have live emotions. We can sense and feel things. We have guilt. And that might not sound like a good thing, but it really is a good thing because it patrols our behavior and it helps make us the responsible star beings that we always were. So we're going into, I don't know, you could call it the age of Aquarius, you could call it graduation, but human consciousness wants to expand. We want to grow past this matrix, and we're doing a lot. It's happening all over. People are waking up. People that you'd never think of would be interested in the stories behind the stories in the news are really now waking up and finding out what's going on. So it's on, it's happening, and that's one of the reasons we do this World Beyond Belief podcast. It's called the World Beyond Belief because the presentation of reality that we talk about and work through and think about on this show is way outside the normal range of beliefs. You could say our beliefs are extreme, but I don't think they are. I think the other beliefs where you live in a constant state of war, you're enslaved by the monetary system, and governments maintain their position by violence, I think that's insanity. I think our view of reality is a lot more sane, where people and human consciousness itself is a peaceful entity, wanting to live in peace and expand our consciousness, learn things and grow. And so in showing this world beyond the belief of many, we're hoping that more of you can be more relaxed as you find out things that you never thought possible, as you see the other side of reality that the mainstream media doesn't tell you about and shields you from, actually. So I think it's a view of reality that we're going to talk about, and I'm going to try to be comforting. I'm going to try to be reinforcing as we all go through this general awakening and on to expanding our consciousness. So it's a nice thing that we feel like we're doing, and I hope that you enjoy these podcasts as much as we enjoy making them. I also want to tell you about a process. A long time ago, maybe 30, 35 years ago, I got involved in A Course in Miracles. Now, A Course in Miracles was a supposedly channeled book from Jesus Christ. And it was way before I was into conspiracies. Since then, I've learned that the CIA was very much involved in producing and promoting The Course in Miracles. But it still had a lot of different concepts and a lot of good information in it that I've maintained to this day. And one of the concepts they have, I think, fits right in, and fits in with the world beyond belief, too, is that the world that you're told to believe in, the world of the matrix, the world of mainstream media, the world that you were educated to think was reality, is really the exact opposite of reality. I mean, if they're telling you white is black, the opposite is white is white. So it's a process of giving up what you thought was real and getting over and facing in the other direction. Mindy and I go through this all the time, and so does anyone else who's actually really involved in the process of awakening and really just doesn't discard things that confront their ego, but actually learns about them and holds them loosely until they find out whether they're true or not. One thing that happened to us pretty recently, actually within the last 10 months, was the discovery of Dave McGowan's book called Weird Scenes from Inside the Canyon. Mm-hmm. And we learned that the hippie movement that Mindy and I were very much involved with really wasn't exactly what we thought it was. There was a lot of subterfuge, a lot of intelligence agents involved, a very big satanic influence. Certainly everybody's aware of all the murders. Well, they weren't called murders. They were called drug overdoses or suicides. But they're very suspicious. So we read that, and it changed our head about the hippie movement. We didn't realize that the hippie movement was an overlay for the genuine peace and equality movement that tries to come out and tries to be dominant every 80 years or so. But the one that we were involved in was very much corrupted, and instead of being really after them for wars and inequality, we chose to go with sex, drugs, and rock and roll, which is, you know, the satanic direction that they put our feet on. So we were kind of lost there. But anyway, I'll come back to that in a minute. But it was like little by little we got turned around. Oh, is that true? Oh, then this could be true. Well, then, and each of these little incremental changes from looking one way to looking the real way, from looking the way that the matrix teaches you to look for truth, happens in little increments. If you considered it 180 degrees from one way or another, there'd be 180 of these little increments. And the Course in Miracles says that each of these little increments is a miracle. And I believe that more than anything. Because to try to wake people up, to try to get them to understand that the world that they've been taught to believe that they're living in is really not the world that they're living in, to teach them that mandatory schooling is not the same as free schooling, to teach them that we may not live in a physical universe and all those concepts might be misleading. All these are miracles. And many times we'll talk to people about seeing something a little different and they'll just dig their heels in. They can't see it. They're not going to go there. And it would take a miracle to get them to change that 1 degree. So I think that's what we're all going through. We're all going through these little miracles, one after the other. People that listen to this podcast are way ahead of the others, I'm sure, in their embracing new information. Let's find out what's true. Because, you know, when we all get to what's true, we're going to be on firm foundation, and we're going to be able to really expand our consciousness because we're going to be standing on things that are true. We're going to be standing on a true history. We're going to be standing on a true rendition of the history of our species. We're going to be standing on a true rendition of what actually happened in World War II and World War I. Who were behind these things? We're going to know all this. Alfred Lambermont Weber often says that we're on a new positive timeline. And in that timeline, everybody's going to know everything. So I think it's important that we all know that the transformation of consciousness is happening. It's struggling. The forces for matrix control are going through everything they can, and we've got a couple examples of what they do, the kind of stuff that they do to keep us down, but it's not going to work. We are on the positive timeline, and we are going to see through this. Well, anyway, while I was going through information, well, I read an interesting article, and the article was just kind of a review of the situation of 911, and the person that wrote this article was very excited because he had seen a representative from Architects and Engineers for Truth, for 911 Truth, on C-SPAN. It was on C-SPAN. And the reason that he was blown away, of course, he's an awakening person like we are. And the reason he was blown away by this interview is because the calls that came in to ask this expert information about 911 were cordial and wonderful. There was one person who wanted to dispute a fact, but everybody else was really thankful for Architects and Engineers. Now, the interviewer, of course, is controlled media, so he's going to want to discredit this person all the way through. If you have a chance, it's a C-SPAN interview for 911 Truth, and all they're simply calling for is an investigation because there's so many anomalies in that one false flag. As going over that and watching the C-SPAN interview, I was thinking that, you know, this is something that we really need to immerse ourselves in. Now listen to this. This is the most important event in your life. It's the most important event in your children's life, and it's the most important event in your maybe yet unborn children's children life. This is the event that launched the war on terror. Without this event, there would be no war on terror. There would be no Homeland Security, there would be no TSA, and we wouldn't get hit with a constant barrage of false flags that we have to react to and debunk every week, as we will later on as we talk about Charlie Hebdo. But anyway, it's very important that we know all the facts about 911. So I had seen a lot of videos on 911, but we got back involved in reading things and watching different information presentations on 911. And damn, I was amazed. The researchers have been working on this thing for, 12 years now? And they know everything. I mean, if you look at Loose Change, the new incarnations of Loose Change, they can tell you a lot about what happened and what the circumstances were. But there are other researchers that have gone into who did it, who's responsible, how did they do it. All of these things are explained in many videos with information that I think is going to be very hard to debunk. Now, do I think there'll ever be an investigation on this? Not by any government that's in existence today. Certainly not the American government. There might be a small government. I know Malaysia allowed war tribunal courts to occur. Of course, it was soundly punished by Downing Flights MH17 and MH370. But still, it allowed those trials to begin. If there ever could be something like that, it would be amazing. But I think our best tactic is for all of us to be aware of all those videos. I mean, the videos that I'm referring to really talk about who benefited. And oddly enough, the same people that benefited from this had the motive? They had the motive, and also they had the method. They were in charge of mechanisms that could shut down the Strategic Air Command that was supposed to be guarding it. They had mechanisms that allowed planes to be switched around. And it's incredible. The one of the videos has who made money on this. And it's incredible how close the people that made money on this were to the people who could actually do it. So it's a pretty well-defined false flag operation that installed the war on terror and pushed us into the Patriot Act 1 and 2, the NDAA Act. I guess it's not an act, it's just a piece of legislation signed into law by Obama, which is, of course, illegal. But that doesn't seem to stop this gang of criminals that are running the country now. Anyway, I'd like you to go to our website or just go to YouTube and work your way through the 911 videos. Find out who was responsible, how it was done. You can know all this stuff. It's all there now. It's honest to God, it's the most important event of your life. It's the reason why the TSA exists. It's the reason why you have to get naked at the airport and they fill you all up. It's the reason why you were walking through naked body scanners that were not only embarrassing, but also exposed you to high levels of radiation. The TSA workers themselves near those machines were exposed to high levels of radiation. It's the reason that we have Homeland Security. It's the reason we have FEMA camps. It's the most important event. I mean, you can say, well, the birth of my first child was the most important. No, it wasn't. Because your child is going to have to live under this regime, live under the matrix as it gets tighter and tighter, and they shut off our methods of communications and our thoughts. I mean, they're trying to, with this Charlie Hebdo thing, not to jump ahead too much, but they're trying to call us, anybody that thinks out of the box, extremists. Which I will say it's an upgrade over the war on terror, though. The war on terror is an amazing invention. It's just due to the fact, it works simply because we all went through 12 years of schooling where we were taught to be obedient. We were taught to believe the mainstream. We were taught to trust the government. And we learned well, and we did well. Because without that teaching, I mean, if we were taught to actually look at things logically, we would have never accepted the war on terror. That's the most ridiculous thing in the world. Now, terror is just extreme fear, isn't it? I mean, when you're terrified, you're afraid, but you're like real, real afraid, you know? So they've created a thing. Well, they did a war on drugs before this, but they created a thing where they're making war on things that frighten us. So I think that's a really interesting notion. So anything that frightens us could be called terrorism. And the people that do this stuff are called terrorists, even though after this attack happened, some of the most outrageous, terrifying acts were perpetrated by the U.S. government. And of course, we all know, if you do your research on 911, that many of the people in government were behind the 911 attacks. I'll say it straight out. I mean, there's plenty of evidence. If someone wants to take me to task on that, we can do a debate. I don't care about it. Anyway, we're involved in this war on terror. Now, they want to convert it with Hebdo case, with the Charlie Hebdo thing, to a war on extremism. Now, extremism threatens the status quo because it wants to get through the truth. It's the awakening of consciousness. It's the guys who investigate fringe items. It's the guys who investigate the other side of the story that actually go out and talk to Muslims to find out that they're not really crazy. They're just people like us. They want peace the same as we do. Remember the Madame Rothschild quote. She once said, "If my sons didn't want war, there would be no war." So we're tricked into these wars. We're tricked into wasting our lives fighting these crazy things that are profiting the people who did 9/11 and then subsequently took us to Afghanistan, Iraq, Libya, on and on and on. Anyway, an interesting thing that's happening now is there seems to be a conflict between the U.S. and Russia, or they're trying to create one. I'm not sure what's true and false for that. I'm not sure whether Russia is in controlled opposition or whether Russia is actually standing up to the Western Rothschild Rockefeller control matrix. I'm not sure what's happening. But I'll tell you one thing that I do know is Russia today and the Russian media are coming out and exposing a lot of the things that the U.S. government is doing. And one of the things I noticed this week was Russia Today was talking about 9/11. Let's take a listen.
My name is Daniel Bush. Your top officials say the White House is behind the terrorism of their population and new evidence from 9/11. Terror against their own population blamed on extremists has actually been funded and planned by the White House. Top-level officials in the government and the CIA confirmed. A campaign known as Gladio is called by former CIA head Bill Colby a, quote, major operation. In sworn testimony, one of the conspirators confessed, "You have to attack civilians, the people, women, children, far removed from any political game, so authorities can bring in a state of emergency." Dr. Daniel Ganser, author of NATO's Secret Armies, thanks very much indeed for coming on. So mainstream media don't report this, but it is now on the record and officially documented that decades of terror attacks against their own population are in fact organized by the CIA and the White House.
Operation Northwoods, with evidence of Operation Gladio, we have the data now available. And then the people understand that this exists, but they still have a psychological moment where they have a hard time to believe that it still goes on, because it's bad news, you know? It basically means that terrorism can be manipulated in order to move people around like sheep, really. And if you're told you're a sheep and you're being moved by false flag terrorism, I mean, this is really something you don't want to hear.
Yeah, we keep finding this term strategy of tension by the White House. What does it mean?
Strategy of tension actually means that you blow up a bomb and say your enemy did it. What we do have is evidence that this strategy of tension goes on. It's not over.
Bigger than Watergate, the FBI's Dennis Sacker calls U.S. shielding al-Qaeda leaders up to 2001 and reports veterans today still ongoing. FBI whistleblower Sybil Edmonds has exposed the, quote, innumerable regular meetings between U.S. representatives and bin Laden's deputy, now head of al-Qaeda, Ayman al-Zawahiri, leading up to September 2001. July 2001, FBI agents closing in on the 9/11 plotters were thrown off the case and threatened with prosecution. Then, when officers arrested Mohammed Khalifa, directly linked to America's most wanted terrorist, Ramzi Youssef, the Secretary of State himself intervened, had Khalifa immediately deported to Saudi and released.
People at the CIA were rich, not even speaking in retrospect, but contemporaneous with what the intelligence community knew. Khalifa's deportation was unreal.
Dr. Kevin Barrett is the author of Questioning the War on Terror. Great to speak to you. We actually have leaders admitting these terrorists are just tools.
And that's what al-Qaeda is. It's a cat's paw for Western intelligence agencies. And we heard this from the Arab world's leading political commentator, Mohammed Haykal, who told us immediately after 9/11 that this official story of 9/11 is ridiculous. He said when he was at the highest levels of government in Europe, he was the one who was in charge of essentially infiltrating and virtually running so-called al-Qaeda. He said al-Qaeda is full of people from Saudi intelligence, from U.S. intelligence, Israeli intelligence, and of course Egyptian intelligence. It couldn't do anything on its own. British scholar Nafis Ahmad, who's one of the world's leading scholars of terrorism and one of the best, talks about an incident that happened in Turkey. I believe this was a little bit before 9/11. A supposed senior al-Qaeda commander was arrested in Turkey And the guards at the prison, who were devout Muslims, noticed that he wasn't praying. He was asking for pork. And they said, "What? You know, we thought you were a radical Muslim." And he kind of laughed and said, no, this is all just a strategy of tension.
This 9/11, the world's top physicists, pilots, engineers joined victims' families to sidestep the mainstream media wall of silence. Huge billboards on Times Square and across the states confront the fact most Americans don't know a third giant tower on 9/11 wasn't even hit by a plane, yet somehow collapsed in free fall. At 5:20 p.m., World Trade 7 suddenly, neatly, and symmetrically just folded like a pancake.
This is high school physics.
A building cannot do free fall with 40,000 tons of structural steel in its structural system without it being blown up.
The government version is that office fires made all 84 steel columns break at the same time. But there are other versions. John Coles, among thousands of leading independent experts with architects and engineers for 9/11 Truth. Great to speak to you. So who did it?
Who didn't do it is the 19 hijackers that allegedly flew the plane. It is impossible. It is impossible to melt that steel by the office fires, the jet fuel, or the collapse itself. It's a physical impossibility. It cannot be replicated experimentally. It defies the laws of physics. If you set aside your politics, you set aside your beliefs and your religion, and you use the scientific method, World Trade Center 7 is basically a classic controlled demolition that where a building free falls and comes straight down into virtually its own footprint. The only explanation that explains all the evidence, the nanothermite, the iron microspheres, the high temperatures found out there, the free fall, the uniform, what I call the uniform acceleration of the towers, when those came down, there was no impact or jolt when it hit the undamaged section below. Because there was no jolt, something blew those towers out, allowing it to uniformly accelerate downward. The only thing that makes any sense at all from a scientific perspective is that those towers were blown up.
John made a mockery of mainstream sites, Nat Geo and Pop Mechanics, who've desperately tried, for instance, to show 175 pounds of military nanothermite couldn't break the columns. John did it with just 1 pound.
Can thermite of any type burn through steel beams?
I guess it can.
Renowned librarian and researcher Elizabeth Woodworth has come in to help form the consensus 9/11 panel, confirming it uses best practice with the most rigorous peer review. Thanks so much for joining us. There's this remarkably high consensus among experts that the government version can't be right.
We have some of the top experts in the field who've published in peer-reviewed scientific journals. And yet, these scientific journals exist, like the Harris study, but they're never covered in the media. If people knew about the research, they would find it compelling. Dr. Griffin has said that he's never heard of anybody who saw the evidence, became converted to this point of view, and then changed back.
Yeah, the panel's made government already change its story and admit Skyscraper 7's freefall.
That's right. David Chandler is an extraordinary model maker. Chandler is on the panel, and he devised a model to prove that the top floors fell with no resistance. There's only one way that that can happen, and that is that all the columns, there are 84 of these columns, that they were severed at the same moment.
Dr. Graham McQueen accessed the New York Fire Department records from that day. Thanks very much for joining us. Never broadcast by mainstream media, but more than 100 witnesses have even reported the explosives bringing down the Twin Towers.
Here was this roughly 10,000 pages of extremely rich eyewitness material. And I found that there were 118 people who clearly perceived explosions. You know, we have firefighters who are used to fighting high-rise fires, who are used to encountering smoke explosions and boilers, and yet they use words like bombs. You know, they don't identify with the things we would expect.
Floor by floor, it started popping out.
It was like, if they had detonated.
Detonated.
If they were planned to take down a building. Boom, 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 boom.
All the way down.
Bob McIlvaine has wanted answers why the post-mortem of his son Bobby found his fatal injuries in the South Tower consistent not with fireballs, but explosives.
information.
Yeah. Mainstream host Rachel Maddow here recently sneered he's not only a conspiracy theorist for asking questions, but also attempted to connect him to violence and Al-Qaeda.
All of these nefarious conspiracies about government plots to kill and conspire and lie about it and cover up the real truth. I mean, this stuff is as ridiculous as it has ever been, but it is as ridiculous as it is dangerous.
Bobby's father joins us. Thank you very much for speaking with us. How do you feel first losing your son and now being portrayed as the bad guy?
My son died. He died from an explosion. I can prove that beyond a reasonable doubt. If I was in a courtroom, a jury cannot not accept that as proof. So that's where we have our problem. When I say, well, this was an inside job. Well, my son died from an inside job from someone putting bombs. Detonations. I would make her sit in this room and go through what I just went with you. And then I would say, now you tell me I'm a conspiracy theorist. Just shows you how awful our media is. I don't want to call her a the media. She makes over $1 million and they tell her what to say. One newspaper reporter, and is from the Philadelphia area, was very upfront with me. She said, you know, Bob, she says, as a reporter, I am the problem because we will lose our jobs. If I take that, just that little bit you just said, so the editor, he will crush it. So I'm telling you right now, I can't put your story out there. The media owners will not allow them. The press would not cover it, just that, because it put a little doubt in people's minds.
Yeah, who do you blame for all this?
The people of the United States are just as much to blame because they just want to believe that we are good people. We are an exceptional country. But this is what governments do. You know, it's very Machiavellian. Now we have an endless war on terror. I know what these people in Iraq, I know what these people in Syria, I know what these people in Libya, Afghanistan we're going through because they're all losing children. And that's what it's all about. Everybody's losing family members. And it's pure hell. So that's it, Daniel.
Tomorrow, Congress votes to bomb Syria, the latest war of the post-9/11 era. The U.S. would now officially be Al-Qaeda's air force, notes former Congressman Kucinich. But America's had enough. 9 in 10 oppose this invasion, the most unpopular in history. Regarding 9/11, a massive 84% now say the government's lying. We now have the precedents documented that government's prepared to commit supreme crimes against its population. Exactly what happened on 9/11 can be argued by both so-called conspiracy theorists and the authorities. What's beyond dispute is on the 11th of September, the world will join to mourn the almost 3,000 innocent people who lost their lives. This is the Truth Seeker.
Okay, that was the Truth Seeker. Now, I'm not so naive as to think that Russia doesn't have an agenda too, because I know they do. But in this particular instance, they're helping us. They're helping us uncover a horrible thing that was perpetrated by mobsters that have infiltrated our government and still are there to this day. So I suggest that we all wake up to the fact that 911 was an inside job. It was perpetrated by people high up in the government, and you don't have to do too much YouTube or too much search to find out the details on exactly who was involved and what happened there. I suggest you do that research so that you know for sure in your mind that 911 was perpetrated by the same people who are controlling the government today. So, if that's the case, then there should have been no restrictive legislation. And all the restrictive legislation, like the Patriot Act, can't be true. It can't be really legitimate. So you can just erase that from your mind. It shouldn't even be there. It was put in place under false pretenses. And then there's these executive orders. Well, not only, I don't want to get off the subject too much, but those executive orders are not legal. The president always excuses himself from those executive orders. There's a process that I learned in ninth grade civics, how a bill becomes a law. That's the process he has to use. And besides, I think that Obama, I mean, if there was anybody that could really investigate Obama, I really don't think he's the president. I don't know what he is, but I think there are plenty of holes in his past, including his citizenship, that might negate all of those executive orders. if we could pin that thing down. Also, all of these restrictive spying, strong arm tactics, random stops on the highway to take your blood, that's all a fabrication. It's all based on 911. There is no war on terror. War on terror is an absurdity. The war on terror is an absurdity. It really can't be, because it was based on a false flag. Well, of course, all of our wars in the 20th century have been based on false flags. Why wouldn't the first one in the 21st century be based on false flags? And now we have to go through, and we have to live through a series of their false flags. And I predicted a couple weeks ago that through 2015, there'll be a gun-related false flag every week. And I think that they're outdoing my prediction. There seems to be one everywhere in the world all the time, happening now. The most highly visible right now is the Charlie Hebdo case. Now, the real reason, the real bottom line that I'm thinking, it's really important that we wake up to 911 and don't play the war on terror, is because of a system that I've talked about many times on this program. It's called the saeculum. And the saeculum measures time in the span of a person's life. And in the span of that life, there go through times of crisis and times of awakening, and they seem to follow one after the other after the other. You go through a crisis, then a little while later you go through an awakening, then a little while later you go through a crisis. And I picture these things as human consciousness, as our transformation coming forward and making a play for freedom. That's what we're doing. And every time we do that, the control matrix cracks down or misdirects us. Let me give you an example. The first crisis that I'm aware of in the 20th century was, it started with the stock market crash, the Great Depression, and then World War II. Now, during a crisis period, there's always a clear winner and a clear loser. And In that particular crisis, there was a war, and the United States and its allies were the winners, supposedly, and Japan, Italy, Germany were the losers. But that's one way to look at it. It could have been an orchestrated war, orchestrated by the banksters. There's a book that I read not too long ago by Anthony C. Sutton called Hitler's Bankers. And it outlined who actually funded Hitler. And actually the same people that funded Hitler funded the United States, funded Russia. I mean, they're all, the banksters funded everybody. So the war with the world, during that crisis period, when consciousness wanted to get up and fight, and there's a group of people born during crisis periods. They're born before a crisis starts to be the active adults during that time. The crisis World War II were the GI generation. They were born to fight that war, and they're a different kind of cat than the rest of us are. They have their act together. They are communitarians. I hate to use that word. They like to band together. They like teamwork. And they struggle for a cause. They're easily conscripted into a cause because this is how consciousness expresses itself during a crisis. So during that crisis, I pulled out some figures a while back from WorldWar2.net. And it shows the casualties in World War II. I'll just go through and name some. I don't know whether you know that Australia lost 31,200 people. Belgium lost 36,095. Those were the soldiers. In addition to that, they lost 30,500 civilians. Canada lost 44,893 soldiers in that war. China lost 2 million people, soldiers, and 11,500,000 civilians. Let's go down the list here. France lost 97,000 people. Germany lost 3,350,000 soldiers and 3 million plus civilians. Who else we might be interested in? Japan lost almost 2 million soldiers and 393,000. The USSR lost 13,708,000 and 65 million civilians. That's our man Stalin, who was our ally, killed most of that 65,000. So I think we know from those statistics who are the losers. If you read Anthony C. Sutton's book, you'll find out who were the winners in that war. And the winners in that war are the same people that we're opposed to now, or we should be opposed to. So rather than that crisis creating an opportunity for us to throw off our masters and expand our consciousness, they tricked us. We had the U.S. fighting Germany, Italy fighting its own people. We had Stalin coming down and making mincemeat out of his own population, all financed by these banker types. So during that crisis, when the heroes rose up and got together to fight and free themselves, free consciousness, they were corrupted and perverted into this dastardly, horrible, devastating World War II. It's supposed to be the good war, but I think if you look into it a little more deeply, you'll find that there might not be, maybe everything isn't so good. Okay, then my generation came up. We were supposed to take part in an awakening, and we were so motivated to end wars on the planet forever, and also make everybody equal. But that's the currency that the control system works on. Inequality, the rulers and the lower class, and they, as many classes as they can make, reinforces that upper and lower stuff. So they couldn't have that. And also, they make so much money on wars. They couldn't have us ending wars. So they did a couple things. One was to corrupt us through the hippie movement, which really derailed a lot of the peace movement, a lot of the equality movement. And then, of course, they did things like pass legislation. They did the 1969 Civil Rights Act. Oh, man, there's nothing. Just legislate something, and you'll make people bump up against it. I mean, if you mandated sex every day, it wouldn't be but 3 months till people were against it. And, you know, so if you're mandating equality, that's not how you do it. You teach it. You started in your education. You take away these different notions that were put in there falsely to separate us. But they need, you know, divide and conquer. And you can't do that if everybody's equal. So they couldn't have that. They ended the Vietnam Wars, and we all thought that, oh, man, we accomplished something. Well, not really. They had plenty of wars going on and have had plenty subsequently. We don't have a national policy against war. We don't even have a group of people that are against war anymore. The peace activists are nowhere to be found. So they derailed the awakening. And now we're in another crisis period. And the heroes that were born to fight in this crisis period or to participate in this crisis period were born between 85 and 2005, and the crisis period started in 2005. Okay. Yeah, now we're in a crisis period again, and we have a fine crop of new heroes. These people are strong and active, and even though their food's poison in the United States, and they've been drinking fluoride, they've tried to get them to take Prozac, and they've been working on, what is that video game, Grand Theft Auto? So they've gotten through it, and they're ready to go. They're ready to fight for the awakening of consciousness. But what's happening now is they're being turned against one another. Look at Ferguson. The blacks are turned against the whites. The police are turned against the people. And now with the Charlie Hebdo thing, everybody's in arms. We're all against the Muslims. And now they're going to try to redirect that toward extremists, which I consider to be divergent thinkers. I mean, the people that are really going to expand consciousness, the people that have the neural connections that are outside the normal range, the ones that are willing to explore things and look into things like time travel, teleportation, and some of the other things that we talk about on this show. The people who are willing to dive into that and really find out are going to be called extremists. So we're going to have all these wonderful, wonderful, shiny new heroes that came in to do this. They're going to be against one another. They're going to be against the Muslims. Now, the Muslims have a crop of heroes the same way. You can't be against one another. You've got to be against the matrix. You've got to be against the controllers. We've got to unite. And we've got this wonderful tool called the internet where we can make a worldwide community. I see the heroes, this hero generation, debugging false flag after false flag. And they're all over this Hebdo case, as you'll find out in the next hour. It's really wonderful to see them, but we can't lose this opportunity because this opportunity comes with the matrix lockdown. This matrix lockdown that they want to put in right now, between now and 2025, will break the back of anybody that's a divergent thinker, will break the back of anybody that's creative. If they can put their plan for Agenda 21 in motion, the people that are left from their depopulation agenda will be living very tightly controlled communities. Everything they do, say, and think, indeed, will be monitored. So I think if that situation is able to be put into place by the Matrix, and they're working on it, really hard, that's the end of the expansion of consciousness. That's game over. And since I think that the expansion of consciousness is all about, I think that this reality, this world, us and all the other species on it, are here for the expansion of consciousness, not just human consciousness, but all consciousness, it'll be game over. I wouldn't be surprised if the whole game board didn't exist, because there's no need for it. There's no need for us to be reincarnating here to make cyborgs for the service of the elites. There's no need for us to come back to have an experience as a sex slave for the rituals that the elites have. So I think it's very important. I think this is the critical time. Our generation, the prophet generation, in this type of activity is called upon to help the heroes, motivate the heroes, and help the heroes train in on what they have to deal with. It would be great, it would be great this time, if this crisis didn't result in a war, that it resulted in a coming together of all the heroes across the planet, all the people they're between 30 and 10, all coming together and finding that we're all one people. We want to live in peace. We don't want to be controlled. We don't want to be surveilled. This phony war on terror, the phony war on the Muslims, this phony shutting down of the internet and shutting down of free speech, shutting down of free thought. That's ridiculous. We don't need that. But what'll happen? We have to be careful we don't get aligned against one another. All you heroes should stand up and recognize all one another as heroes. I mean, social media could be due for that, although it's full of trolls and pitfalls. But anyway, that's what I wanted to say in the first hour on this wonderful transformation that's actually happening. And according to Alfred Lambermann Weber and many other people who are looking into this, we are on a positive timeline. And the reason that we're not seeing the golden age right now is because a lot of people are just refusing to wake up. It's not scary if you wake up. It's scary if you stay asleep. Wake up. Join hands. Get the heroes across the planet to join hands and cast off this horrible matrix that seems to want to be in every orifice of our bodies.
Indeed. Well, we are coming up close to the end of the first hour, so why don't we take a little dance break?
Yeah, I can dance around the living room.
All right. Well, today for our dance break, we're going to listen to Sissy Ridgwick, Gimme That Swing. Here we go. Gimme, 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 gimme that
swing. Well, hope you're not out of breath like I am. Well, welcome back to the World Beyond Belief, second hour here. And we were talking about the hero generation and the heroes now ready to deal with the crisis at hand. The crisis period in this model lasts from 2005 to 225. So we're halfway through it, and they're making their big moves here. I mean, the control system's really making their big moves to separate us, destabilize anything that, you know, the heroes could identify with. I'm not thinking that it's going to work. Did you notice the music that we just played, the swing music? Well, that's the same, that's new hero music. That comes from the generation 1985 to 2005, who are now controlling mainline culture. And they're into swing music. Funny thing that the GI heroes of the 20s to the 40s, their favorite music was swing too. So I think a lot travels with that meme, in addition to the fact that that's a meme for fighting for the expansion of consciousness. Well, anyway, I'll keep revisiting that as we go, because I think that knowing what your role is and knowing who the enemy is critical. You really can't stand up and win our freedom if you're fighting the police, or the police are fighting black people, or the Muslims, or the bad guys that don't make any sense. Well, anyway, I want to jump into this Charlie Hebdo case that happened on January 7th. So there's a Charlie 7 kind of theme to this whole thing that we'll get into more and more. But to set up exactly what went on, and it's going to tell you a little bit about the conspirators bent on this. But let's play a little bit from James Evan Pilato. Now, he explains this, and I think he explains it really well. That's why I don't want to really redo it for you. He explains it well on one of his podcasts with James Corbett. So let's hear James Evan Pilato's explanation of the basics behind the Hebdo case.
The story is the one that is ricocheting all around the world right now as we speak. And I would just say that, you know, you're being emotionally manipulated when all the corporate media outlets all adopt the same propaganda without question. Je suis Charlie? I say A2 Charlie. Paris attack on satirical newspaper, a textbook terror event. Just the facts. On January 7th, 2015, two masked gunmen armed with Kalashnikov rifles, a shotgun, an RPG launcher, stormed the headquarters of the French satirical newspaper Charlie Hebdo in Paris. They shot and killed 12 people, including 9 employees and 2 national police officers, and wounded 11 others. Several people have been detained by the police in connection with the attack, while a manhunt is currently underway for the 2 suspects. Or, the other way you could look at it, as our man Anthony Cardellucci of Land Destroyer puts it, Paris gunmen spoke French perfectly, likely French who were radicalized in one of the many mosques Western intelligence agencies run and monitor, sent to one of NATO's many proxy wars, trained, armed, fought with NATO backing, came back and carried out this attack, likely with help from handlers, all the while being well known to authorities. Just the shooters claiming they were from Al-Qaeda, demonstrating martial prowess that suggests training, implicates the West and its vast network of state-sponsored terrorism. Meanwhile, global research says this mirrors almost verbatim the type of ops NATO intelligence carried out during the Cold War, with similar networks of radicalized militants used as both foreign mercenaries and domestic provocateurs. Toward even the end of the Cold War, one of these militant groups was literally Al-Qaeda, a proxy mercenary front armed, funded, and employed by the West to this very day. So additionally, in all likelihood, the brothers who took part in the attack in Paris may have been fighting in Syria with weapons provided to them by the French government itself. France 24 would report that President François Hollande said that France had delivered weapons to rebels battling the Syrian regime of Bashar al-Assad a few months ago. So deflecting blame for the current attack on radical Islam is but a canard obscuring the truth that these terrorists were created intentionally by the West to fight the West's enemies abroad and to intimidate and terrorize their populations at home. James, this can go on, but the main question, I think, is who benefits? And our man Pepe Escobar has a piece on Russia Today that says this was a pro job that just happened to take place a couple of days after France recognized Palestinian statehood and a few days after Hollande demanded the lifting of sanctions against the Russian threat. So I think, James, just like the Sony hack where international terrorists pull off a massive attack only to, I left behind my language data. They're alleging that these guys have been identified because they left their ID card behind in the getaway car, just like the passports that they've shucky darns, dropped on 9/11. So as this is still a developing story, James, I'm imagining there's going to be some Friday night showdown as the masses all tune into the TV and cheer on more murder, a la the Boston bombing miniseries, which again is sort of still kind of playing out here in America as they're going into selecting of the jurors in the Boston bombing case.
Yeah, that's very interesting. That was James Evan Pilato explaining actually what happened or what the mainline viewpoint is. And not the mainline viewpoint, but what we should be looking at as people who debunk these things. Now, there have been a lot of people debunking the various vehicles that were used, the fact that the passport was left behind. Supposedly they shot a policeman, but the policeman didn't bleed. And there were other holes in their case. It was very, very well executed, except for they left their passports in the car. I mean, it's an easy one to debunk if anybody cares to take the trouble. But the real reaction that they want to get in the mainline media, I know in the United States is working for, is this, let's go out and kill Muslims. And I want to play an example from our old friend, Judge Jeanine, beating this drum to kill the Muslims. Let's play a little excerpt from her, because I play them to get some laughs, but I'm always repulsed at the end. So let me show you what she has to say on this.
All right, let's do it.
Hello and welcome to Justice. I'm Judge Jeanine Pirro. Thanks for being with us tonight. We need to kill them. We need to kill them. The radical Muslim terrorists hell-bent on killing us. You're in danger. I'm in danger. We're at war, and this is not going to stop. After this week's brutal terror attacks in France, hopefully everybody now gets it. And there's only one group that can stop this war, the Muslims themselves. Our job is to arm those Muslims to the teeth, give them everything they need to take out these Islamic fanatics. Let them do the job. Let them have at it. And as they do, we need to simply look the other way. It is time for this to be over and stop sending American dollars to any Arab country that does not support this mission. Pakistan at the top of the list. Force Arab nations to choose.
Yeah, she's extremely scary. And of course she wants to kill the Muslims because she works for the banksters that own all these media, and they want you to war against yourselves, heroes. They want you to fight one another. They want the Muslims in the Middle East, I guess, to rise up against ISIL and Al-Qaeda, which are armed and created and armed by the West and funded. So you see, it's all a big trap. They fund the terrorist, and then they react to the terrorists by limiting our freedoms and having us attack the poor people that they funded and set against us in the first place. It's maniacal as hell. And it's happening now. And the Hebdo case is a really good example. Do you have anything to say about Judge Jeanine?
Oh, she just intimidates. I can't stand to listen to her. But she does make me laugh at the same time because she's just a trip.
Yeah, I think that she's an extremist.
Yes.
I mean, she certainly is extreme to me.
Kill him!
Kill him! We've got to bomb the shit out. Anyway, that's what we're going to do. Anyway, while we were experiencing this week and going through the events unfolding in the Hebdo, our good friend of this show, Alfred Lammermon Weber, made some interesting remarks. Now, the reason I want to detour into Alfred Lammermon Weber is because he shows a different, you know, Alfred is in touch with a positive timeline. He sees the unfolding of consciousness. He sees the bigger picture. And after we talk about what Alfred says, then we're going to get back into mainline, what they're doing, concrete things that they're doing. But I think it's interesting to take a little side trip into Alfred's comments because he had just spent 7 or 8 hours interviewing a woman who calls herself Charlie Seven. Now, Charlie Seven is a creative genius and was a fashion model. And the controllers keep an eye on Charlie Seven. The reason she got her name is because I think maybe the family's name is Charlie. She was the seventh person to be born. She was the seventh child. Well, anyway, she created a plethora of ideas to revolutionize the way mainstream media treated health, physical fitness and things. She created things like all the dance contests that are on TV today. She had them all lined out, laid out, and it was brilliant. So the organization, the control system, stole them from her. And not only did they steal them from her, but they started torturing her. They stole her name. She called herself Seven now, but she was Charlie Seven. They made a series where there was a person on there called Charlie Seven. They threatened her life. They threatened to torture her. Can you remember anything else that happened?
Well, I know that they made trillions of dollars off of selling all of her ideas to various television networks around the world, and they used the money to fund the terrorist attack on 7-7 in the London subway.
Well, which is named after her, 7-7. That's why they did it. Now, this sounds really wild, but if you listen to those interviews, and they're on Alfred Lammermon Weber's site, exopolitics.com, you can find his interviews with Seven, and I think she's an incredibly credible source, and they're putting her through hell. Now, it just so happens that this false flag happened on the 7th of January to a person named Charlie Hebdo. So Alfred, who, you know, when you want to see what's going on, you really have to step back, really step back, and look for patterns of things. Try to keep yourself from delving into the details. Do your synthesis first, open-minded synthesis. But let's hear Alfred weigh in on the Charlie Hebdo situation.
All right, here we go.
I think it's not Palestine. It's much more direct. What happened was that on the day before the attacks, on January 6th, the French president came out and held a major press conference in which he said that France will now be seeking a diplomatic rapprochement with Russia. And he signaled that France was jumping camp from the Rothschild camp and would become part of BRICS. And the reaction was swift. The next day, the Rothschild military arm, which is in the U.S., it's the CIA, in England, it's MI6, MI5. In Israel, it's the Mossad. They activated their jihad, and the attack was a military attack against France by the U.S., by Britain, against France because of its diplomatic attempt to jump camp into the BRICS camp the day before. And this
Will they carry on? Will they do it anyways?
No, but let me finish my analysis. And there is an overarching structure, which is an international war crimes racketeering organization, which goes beyond nations, which is just a bunch of crooks that goes from the British monarchy through the lawyers, through the television, through the news, whereby they steal, and then they use all of this to create the false flags and to finance things like ISIS and like the event in Paris, France, and the event on 7/7, and we call that Sevengate. And you can go to newsinsideout.com and find out Sevengate. Well, that's all done according to a very kind of secret masonry or secrecy around Seven, Charles Seven or Charlie Seven, who is a very creative UK television concept inventor that 11 years ago, they stole all of her concepts, sold them to BBC, to ABC, to all the major television networks in 120 nations. Things like Dancing with the Stars, a whole new genre of television. And with that, they financed 7/7. And they used all these, you know, Sevens and Charlies. Well, it was Charlie Hebdo, Charlie Seven. So Sevengate, it was inside the whole Sevengate masonry. So the false flag in Paris was picked up into the psyops energy of 7/7, of all of the television magic that they're doing through all the purloined properties like Dancing with Stars. And then they hit Charlie Hebdo, like Charlie Seven, like the trouble with Charlie. So this is truly like living in Mordo. You're living with black magicians that are an organized criminal syndicate that is global, that is playing with your psyche, that is stealing all the creative properties and using them to pull off terrorist activities, that is an attack on your country because it's trying to make a deal with the only honest politicians in town, which are Putin and China, except that Putin is, to some extent, you could say that it's controlled opposition, at least in the sense that he is now making sure that all the Belarusian commanders get off because he doesn't want the Belarusian troops that are now establishing themselves as a sovereign entity in the eastern Ukraine to ignite a sovereignty, because the true sovereignty of 2015 is not the sovereignty of BRICS and the megastate of Putin and China. It's the sovereignty of the individual soul and the individual person. And that's what's happening in the Belarusia area there. And so there's a complex, multi-layered dynamic going on that I invite people to step outside of their, you know, step outside of all of the boxes that you've known, and really start following this thing for its multi-layered dynamics into new areas. We are ascending up densities of consciousness, and that's what's occurring.
I always like to play Alfred because he gives us a little bit more of the esoteric side, and he's such a credible source. So I like to listen to him. And I think it's important that we all remember that this is basically a spiritual war or a spiritual awakening. And there's a lot of forces there that are on our side. I know it's really easy for us to look at the matrix and see how it's control education, it controls the media, it's able to pull off these really sophisticated false flags like 9/11 and Sandy Hook and say, wow, how can just human consciousness, how can us folks really compete with that? Well, I'll tell you, we can. That's why they're so terrified, because when consciousness expands, we won't need them anymore. They're superfluous. They're a trial that we've made it past. And their way of life and their way of control is finished. So they're fighting like hell against us. Actually, very much like hell against us. But it's a spiritual war. And you have to remember that there's many other levels of this war going on and a lot of forces that are certainly on our side, working with us, but we have to, as human consciousness, as world consciousness, we have to see it as a spiritual war and awaken and not be afraid to learn things, not be afraid to look into fringe subjects, not be afraid to see synchronicities that happen as indicating something. We need to remember that it's a spiritual war. There's a lot more at stake than just us, but we're really... We really need to be human consciousness, world consciousness, working toward this expansion too. And so that's what we try to promote here on World Beyond Belief. The fact that we're engaged in a really strange thing right now, that if the positive timeline turns out to be true, which I believe it is, I mean, I can point to so many facts that show me that it's true, including how quickly the alternative media was all over this Charlie Hebdo thing. Anyway, let's get back to the main line. And I'm going to read a little bit of an article from Paul Craig Roberts. Now, if you follow this podcast at all, you know that he's one of my favorites because he's an older guy, and he was a conservative. He was with the Reagan administration. And now he has started to awaken. And he's starting to awaken a lot of people. And he has a lot of credibility with a lot of people. But let me get into his article called Charlie Hebdo. Charlie Hebdo affair has many of the characteristics of a false flag operation. The attack on the cartoonist's office was a disciplined professional attack of the kind associated with highly trained special forces. Yet the suspects, who were later corralled and killed, seemed bumbling and unprofessional. It's like two different sets of people. Usually, Muslim terrorists are prepared to die in the attack. Yet the two professionals who hit Charlie Hebdo were determined to escape and succeed an amazing feat. Their identity was allegedly established by the claim that they conveniently left, for the authorities, their ID in the getaway car. Such a mistake is inconsistent with the professionalism of the attack and reminds me of the undamaged passport found miraculously among the ruins of the two World Trade Center towers that served to establish the identity of the 911 hijackers. It is plausible inference that the ID left behind in the getaway car was the ID of the two Kouochi brothers, convenient patsies, later killed by police, and from whom we will never hear anything, and not the ID of the professionals who attacked Charlie Hebdo. An important fact that supports this inference is the report that the third suspect of the attack, Hamid Mourad, the alleged driver of the getaway car, when seeing his name circulating on social media as a suspect realized the danger he was in and quickly turned himself into the police for protection against being murdered by security forces as a terrorist. Hamid Mourad says he has an ironclad alibi. If so, this makes him the despoiler of a false flag attack. Authorities will have to say that despite being wrong about Mourad, they were right about the Kouachi brothers. Alternatively, Mourad could be coerced or tortured into some sort of confession that supports the official story. Or they could just torture him and then say he's at it, you know. The American and European media have ignored the fact that Mourad turned himself in for protection from being killed as a terrorist, as he had an alibi. I Googled Hamid Mourad, and all I found, January 12th, was the main U.S. and European media reporting that the third suspect had turned himself in. The reason for his surrender was left out of the reports. The news was reported in a way that gave credence to the accusation that the suspect who turned himself in was part of the attack on Charlie Hebdo. Not a single U.S. mainstream media source reported that the alleged suspect turned himself in because he has an ironclad alibi. Some media merely reported Mourad's surrender in a headline with no coverage on the report. The list I Googled includes the Washington Post. Die Welt, which says, quote, one suspect has turned himself into police in connection with Wednesday's massacre in the offices of Parisian satirical magazine Charlie Hebdo. ABC News says the youngest suspect in Charlie Hebdo attack turns himself in. CNN says, quote, citing sources, the Agence France-Presse news agency reported that an 18-year-old suspect in the attack had surrendered to police. Another puzzle in the official story that remains unreported by the prostitute media is the alleged suicide of a high-ranking member of the French judicial police who had an important role in the Charlie Hebdo investigation. For unknown reasons, Helric Fideu, a police officer involved in the most important investigation of a lifetime, decided to kill himself in his police office on January 7th or 8th. Both dates are reported in the foreign media. In the middle of the night, while writing his report on his investigation, a Google search as of 6 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, January 13, turns up no mainstream U.S. media report on this event. The alternative media reports it, as do some U.K. newspapers, but without suspicion or mention whether this report has disappeared. The official story is that Fardou was suffering from depression and burnout, but no evidence is provided. Depression and burnout are the standard explanations of mysterious deaths that have unsettling implications. Now, also, this is Paul again. I'm off the article. Apparently, he shot himself in the back of the head, but he used his left hand rather than his right hand. So there are some suspicious information about this suicide. And since now we all know that the controllers frequently suicide people if they have information that they think is inconvenient, I have a tendency to think it might be. Back to Paul Roberts. Once again, we see the U.S. print and TV media serving the Ministry of Propaganda for Washington. In place of investigation, the media repeats the government's implausible story. It behooves us all to think. Why would Muslims be more outraged by cartoons in a Paris magazine than by hundreds of thousands of Muslims killed by Washington and its French and NATO vassals in seven countries during the past 14 years? Good question, Paul. If Muslims wanted to make a point of these cartoons, why not bring a hate crime or lawsuit? Imagine what would happen to a European magazine that dared to satirize Jews in the way Charlie Hebdo satirized Muslims. Indeed, in Europe, people are imprisoned for investigating the Holocaust without entirely confirming every aspect of it. Good points. Also, this is Paul again. I'm off of Paul Roberts. It happens on the 7th of January. Now, this is after the U.S. Congress vowed to come back after recess and pass some really stringent legislation shutting down free thought on the Internet. And this just happens, just like right now. They've been drawing cartoons of Muslims. Hebdo's agency have been drawing cartoons of Muslims for years and years. Back to Paul Roberts' article. If a Muslim lawsuit was deep-sixed by French authorities, the Muslims would have made their point. Killing people merely contributes to the demonization of Muslims, a result that only serves Washington's wars against Muslim countries. If Muslims are responsible for the attack on Charlie Hebdo, what Muslim goal did they achieve? None whatsoever. Indeed, the attack attributed to the Muslims has ended French and European sympathy and support for Palestine and European opposition to the U.S. wars against Muslims. Just recently, France had voted in the UN with Palestine against the U.S.-Israel position. This assertion of an independent French foreign policy was reinforced by the recent statement by the President of France that the economic sanctions against Russia should be terminated. Sounds like Russia's getting out of line. Clearly, France is showing too much foreign policy independence. The attack on Charlie Hebdo serves to cow France and place France back under Washington's thumb. Some will contend that Muslims are sufficiently stupid to shoot themselves in the head in this way. But how do we reconcile such alleged stupidity with the alleged Muslim 9/11 and Charlie Hebdo professional attacks? If we believe the official story, the 9/11 attack on the U.S. shows that 19 Muslims, largely Saudis, without any government or intelligence service support, outwitted not only all 16 U.S. intelligence agencies, the National Security Council, Dick Cheney, and all the neoconservatives in high positions throughout the U.S. government, and airport security, but also the intelligence services of NATO and Israel's Mossad. How can such intelligent and capable people, who delivered the most humiliating blow in world history to an alleged superpower with no difficulty whatsoever, despite giving every indication of their intentions, possibly be so stupid as to shoot themselves in the head when they could have thrown France into turmoil with a mere lawsuit? The Charlie Hebdo story simply doesn't wash. If you believe it, you're no match for a Muslim. Some who think that they are experts will say that a false flag attack in France would be impossible without the cooperation of French intelligence. To this I say that it's practically a certainty that the CIA has more control over French intelligence than does the President of France. Operation Gladio proves this. The largest part of the government of Italy was ignorant of the bombings conducted by the CIA, and Italian intelligence against European women and children and blamed on the communists in order to diminish the communist vote in the elections. Americans are pitifully misinformed people. All of history is history of false flag operations, yet Americans dismiss such proven operations as conspiracy theories, which merely proves that governments have successfully brainwashed insouciant Americans and deprived them of the ability to recognize the truth. Americans are the foremost among the captive nations. Who will liberate them? Pretty powerful article.
Very powerful.
I think he says it like it is. Why would the Muslims do this? They'd be shooting themselves in the foot. What they're doing is they're creating animosity against their own kind. So I think it's really hardly practical that they did that. Also, unexpectedly, the PM and current president of Turkey, Recep Tayyip Erdogan. It's a NATO member. Now, Turkey's a NATO member. He did the unthinkable. He accused the West, and the French citizens in particular, of staging the Charlie Hebdo murder in order to blame Muslims, even as the mayor of Ankara said, Mossad is definitely behind such incidents. It is boosting enmity toward Islam. So we find that people in the Middle East, including NATO members, are realizing the damage that Mossad is probably doing. Mossad and the CIA and all these MI6 are all the same organization. They all work hand in hand. Recep also went on to say, as Muslims, we have never sided with terror or massacres. Racism, hate speech, Islamophobia are behind these massacres. He also said, the culprits are clear. French citizens undertook this massacre, and Muslims were blamed for it. See, there's a big thing going on in France, and has been for 10 years. I can remember going there in the early 90s, and people would openly say they were racist. Well, they were racist against Muslims, because Muslims, I don't know whether you know anything about the French culture, but they pride themselves on being the moral and cultural standard bearers of the Western world. Honestly, they dine. It's an elegant ritual when they dine. You know, they like fine music, and they pride themselves in their wine. And Muslims were immigrating to France even in the early 90s. So it's very plausible that the French people could be doing this, although I'm really sure it's a CIA and Mossad operation. Melek Gökrek, mayor of Ankara, who I mentioned before, for the ruling AK party, said on Monday that Mossad, which is the Israeli intelligence service, is definitely behind such incidents. It's boosting its enmity toward Islam. Also, another thing that's happening is the Jews are leaving Paris, and they're being welcomed with open arms by Netanyahu. So that's happening. You know, the plan is to get all the Jews back to Israel, so when they destroy that country, they'll be wiping out that whole race, or they'll be trying to. The Zionists will be trying to. At the end of this article, it says, quote, for the last 10 years, so-called Islamic terrorism has been under the control of one of the world's leading intelligence agencies. I am sure that some American supervisors are responsible for the terror attacks in Paris, or in any case, the Islamists who carried them out. This was said by Alexei Martinov, director of the International Institute for New States, a think tank, told this to a pro-Kremlin internet outlet called Life News. So I wonder what would give the Russians the idea that this is a Mossad operation. I wonder. The last thing I want to bring to your attention is a great article I found by a person named Brandon Smith on Zero Hedge. And he talks about what the bottom line is going to be or is on this false flag attack. And he does it by analyzing a Reuters article called White House to Hold Global Security Summit, February 18th. Now, I don't know whether you know, but in the United States, there are two news services. One is the AP, Associated Press, and the other is Reuters. Now, I can't remember which owns which, but they're both the same operation, and they're both controlled by either the Rothschilds or the Rockefellers. It doesn't really matter. They're controlled by the cabal. So all the news that comes out is through those two news services, which is totally controlled. So let me go down and let me read through this article. I think that Brandon Smith makes some excellent points. He says, it's clear by the language being used by the political elite that the global summit called in the wake of the Charlie Hebdo attack is about far more than radical Islamic terrorism. Set aside the fact that our government essentially created ISIS in order to destabilize Syria. Set aside the fact that the globalist middlemen like John McCain and former covert ops goon like General Paul Vallely have met directly with groups like the Nasra Front that are providing support for ISIS. Set aside the fact that the Saudi Arabia has been openly funneling cash and arms to Syrian terrorist factions tied to ISIS, and realize that the mere existence of ISIS, regardless of its origins, is being used as a rationale for the erasure of civil liberties and the establishment of martial law on both sides of the Atlantic. Such federalized creations cannot be allowed to continue, regardless of the threats each nation faces. As far as the Reuters article is concerned, one does not need to read very far between the lines to see the true message being conveyed. First, the focus of the summit is not necessarily indicated as, quote, Islamic terrorism. In fact, the word terrorism is barely mentioned. Now, politicos are switching their language to the term extremism, which is far broader in its implications. It should be noted that while the terrorist label has been bandied about rather liberally by both the Bush and Obama administrations, extremism offers greater cover for governments to persecute or attack political opponents. A terrorist is generally someone who initiates or at least plans a large-scale attack designed to elicit a fear response in a population. An extremist, on the other hand, could literally be anyone who holds views or initiates activism outside acceptable forms of mainstream thought. Attorney General Eric Holder did not use the words terrorism or jihadist in his announcement of the global summit in February. He used the phrase violent extremism. And then Brandon quotes a line from the Reuters article, quote, we will bring together all of our allies to discuss ways in which we can counteract this violent extremism that exists around the world. Here's his analysis. Throughout history, violence, according to governments, is often attributed to ideas as well as actions. The point is, the change in vocabulary over to extremist label is not accidental or coincidental. The establishment is conditioning the public to think in broad terms and to identify numerous groups as the enemy, rather than focusing on radical Islam. As I have said for years, Islamic terror is nothing but an advantageous excuse for governments to make war on all of us. Don't forget, constitutionalists are often referred to in the mainstream media and by Orwellian institutions like the Department of Homeland Security as extremists. How long before we're all artificially linked as being suspect? How long before Charlie Hebdo-style attacks come to the U.S.? How long before we are artificially linked as being suspect? How long before Charlie Hebdo-style attacks come to the U.S.? How long before the liberty-minded are categorized as accessories to terrorism due to our anti-corrupt government philosophies? And then he goes on, he's talking about the lockdown of the populace. He says, quote, the lockdown of the populace is already ramping up. The EU is currently discussing the creation of a European passenger name record database, meaning officials hope to create a central database with a file on every single citizen. It's like the no-fly list. And he goes into a few details about that if you want to read the article. I'm going to skip ahead to more revelations on related topics. Brandon starts back, "Unfortunately, travel is the least of our concerns. Free speech is a primary target for the elites. And the internet is clearly outlined as a threat by politicians claiming concern for public safety. This comes in the form of one of the oldest rationalizations for tyranny, the trade-off between freedom and security. The French argue that while free speech is important, some exceptions must be made in order to thwart extremist ideas." I think it's really funny. Remember I was talking to you about the parade of puppets that converged on Paris, all the heads of state like Merkel and Netanyahu was even there. There were 17 countries that came in, and they were all locking arms and walking. Well, what they're it's a strange thing. They're against the radical extremists that shot Hebdo's staff and suppressed free speech. But what they're going to do now in February is to suppress free speech further themselves. Of course, they're puppets, but they can do that. Back to the article he's citing from Reuters. Kaz Nueve said the internet needs to remain a space for free expression, but that Europe should fight against abusive use of the web to spread hate speech, anti-Semitic messages, and the recruiting vulnerable young people for violence. We need to work closely with the internet companies to guarantee the reporting and, if possible, removal of all content that amounts to an apology of terrorism or calls for violence and hatred, he said. We're back to Brandon's analysis. Who gets to determine what speech amounts to an apology of terrorism? Who is the all-benevolent and wise sage who gets to decide what we can and cannot say? Will he be fair and just? Or will he use the power of censorship to attack any and all websites critical of the establishment? What do you think the most likely outcome of such legal procedure will be? Again, how long before websites like the one you're reading now or the podcast you're listening to now are vilified by the extremist label? How long before liberty-minded speech is categorized as violent speech or hate speech? Senator Dianne Feinstein in the White House are now kindly warning the public that terrorist, quote, sleeper cells have been activated and that some are present in the United States. On CNN, Feinstein said, quote, "So I think this calls for vigilance. It calls for seeing that the national security organizations of our country, the intelligence community, is funded fully, is directed ably, is cooperating with whether it be British intelligence, French intelligence, German intelligence, as we do. And the French are good at that. And so are the British and the Germans." She didn't mention the Israelis. "So we can even be more active in terms of doing those things which enable us to find terrorists, to see who are communicating within this country and to track that." Back to Brandon's analysis. She means mass internet and phone surveillance, the same national security agency surveillance exposed by Edward Snowden, which now has a convenient justification in the form of an ever-present fear of terrorism. "Finally, it's only a matter of time before the militarized response is activated in the U.S., just as it has been in France. One shooting event has led to the fielding of over 10,000 French troops on French soil, as well as an extra 5,000 heavily armed police. Frankly, this is where I and many other people like me draw the line. Martial law is not acceptable under any circumstances. I don't care if we one day see a mushroom cloud over an American city. There is no measure of government security, which is false security in this case, that is worse than degradation of essential liberties. I suspect the loss of liberty, usurping of the Constitution, and the deployment of military in U.S. soil would trigger revolution. A revolution, I'm sure, the established would attempt to marginalize as mere terrorism. Ultimately, though, there is no other option. As I've been discussing constantly over the past several months, community preparation and organization comprise the only action plan worth the effort and energy at this time. The French are disarmed and utterly socialized. Millions of them march in Paris in a display of solidarity. But solidarity behind what solution? Even more government? The same government that created the problem in the first place? Even more centralization? The globalization of despotic security policies? The French have dug their grave, and now they're going to have to lie down in it. Americans do not have to follow the same path. We do not need more government. We do not need more surveillance, more police militarization, or more troops in the streets. What we need is to take back responsibility for our own defense. The French government could not or would not protect the staff of Charlie Hebdo, and the U.S. government will not protect you. That means you must train to protect yourself and those you care about, whether we face a false flag attack or a legitimate terrorist action. The response is the same, fight back. This is times like these that separate the courageous from the cowardly. Those with principles and conscience versus the treacherous and self-serving. Make no mistake, as I wrote in my last article, many illusions are about to be shattered. Many illusions are about to be shattered. You can be caught up in the storm as helpless spectator and victim, or you can become a barrier, a wall of defense against the dangerous riptides. These are your choices. Choose wisely. So here we are. We're the prophets who got robbed of our chance to straighten things out in the 65 to 85 awakening that happened. It got taken from us. We got robbed and had very little effect other than creating a whole generation of people with long hair and beards and wearing blue jeans. Now the heroes are up to bat again, and the prophets from our generation really have to show them away because they're new. They've just come in from 1985 to 2005. They didn't live through Watergate. They didn't live through Vietnam. They're barely aware of 9/11. We're the prophet generation. We have to step up and provide leadership. And the leadership we really need to provide is to point out who the enemy is. The enemy isn't Muslim terrorists. The enemy isn't people who think outside the box. The enemy is the control system, the matrix that is sitting on your chest, keeping you from expanding your consciousness. So that's kind of my final word on that subject. We as prophets have to lead, and the heroes have to step up, but they have to be directed by us in the right direction. They have to know who the enemy is. And I don't think it's the Muslim world. Actually, the Muslim, according to a piece of information I just came across, are probably going to be very influential in the world to come, things like Sharia law might be a reality over much of the planet, unless we can come together and make them part of our community, and they can make us part of their community. Let me play you a little clip of a piece that I found about maybe the real Muslim threat, although I don't find these people threatening at all. The real threat is the reproduction rate.
According to research, in order for a culture to maintain itself for more than 25 years, there must be a fertility rate of 2.11 children per family. With anything less, the culture will decline. Historically, no culture has ever reversed a 1.9 fertility rate. A rate of 1.3, impossible to reverse, because it would take 80 to 100 years to correct itself, and there is no economic model that can sustain a culture during that time. In other words, if two sets of parents each have one child, there are half as many children as parents. If those children have one child, then there are one-fourth as many grandchildren as grandparents. If only 1 million babies are born in 2006, it's hard to have 2 million adults enter the workforce in 2026. As the population shrinks, so does the culture. As of 2007, the fertility rate in France was 1.8, England 1.6, Greece 1.3, Germany 1.3, Italy 1.2, Spain 1.1. Across the entire European Union of 31 countries, the fertility is a mere 1.38. Historical research tells us these numbers are impossible to reverse. In a matter of years, Europe as we know it will cease to exist. Yet the population of Europe is not declining. Why? Immigration. Islamic immigration. Of all population growth in Europe since 1990, 90% has been Islamic immigration. France, 1.8 children per family. Muslims, 8.1. In southern France, traditionally one of the most populated church regions in the world, there are now more mosques than churches. 30% of children ages 20 and younger are Islamic. In the larger cities such as Nice, Marseille, and Paris, that number has grown to 45%. By 2027, 1 in 5 Frenchmen will be Muslim. In just 39 years, France will be an Islamic republic. In the last 30 years, the Muslim population of Great Britain rose from 82,000 to 2.5 million, a 30-fold increase. There are over 1,000 mosques, many of them former churches. In the Netherlands, 50% of all newborns are Muslim. And in only 15 years, half of the population of the Netherlands will be Muslim. In Russia, there are over 23 million Muslims. That's 1 out of 5 Russians. 40% of the entire Russian army will be Islamic in just a few short years. Currently in Belgium, 25% of the population and 50% of all newborns are Muslim. The government of Belgium has stated 1/3 of all European children will be born to Muslim families by 2025, just 17 years away. The German government, the first to talk about this publicly, recently released a statement saying, "The fall in the German population can no longer be stopped. Its downward spiral is no longer reversible. It will be a Muslim state by the year 2050. Muammar al-Gaddafi of Libya said, "There are signs that Allah will grant victory to Islam in Europe without swords, without guns, without conquest. We don't need terrorists. We don't need homicide bombers. The 50-plus million Muslims in Europe would turn it into a Muslim continent within a few decades." There are currently 52 million Muslims in Europe. The German government said that number is expected to double in the next 20 years to 104 million. Closer to home, the numbers tell a similar story. Right now, Canada's fertility rate is 1.6, nearly a full point below what is required to sustain a culture. And Islam is now the fastest growing religion. Between 2001 and 2006, Canada's population increased by 1.6 million, 1.2 of those immigration. In the United States, the current fertility rate of American citizens is 1.6. With the influx of the Latino nations, the rate increases to 2.11, the bare minimum required to sustain a culture. In 1970, there were 100,000 Muslims in America. Today, there are over 9 million. The world is changing. It's time to wake up.
Okay, I want to mention, if that's horrifying to you, it actually shouldn't be. I know that radical Muslim groups really insist on Shia law, which is, you know, not really aligned too much with what we consider to be fair law and just, especially for women. But I want to draw to your attention the fact that Muslims and Christians and Jews have lived side by side for thousands of years in the Holy Lands. Before Israel came, it was a very peaceful place. And there has been, before this ramp up of Muslim extremism funded by Saudi Arabia and the United States, there were many Muslim countries that had Christians and Jews, and we all lived together as one. India's Taj Mahal is a monument to how people with different religions can live together. So I wouldn't be terrified of this. But it also speaks to the fact that why would the Muslims have to do terrorist acts? They're taking over the planet just by doing, you know, what comes naturally. So on that note, let me end this episode 129 of World Beyond Belief.
It was great to have you join us. Join us again next week, same time, and we'll catch you then.
Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.